You got to know when to hold them, know when to fold them, know when to walk away, know when to run. The famous Kenny Rogers. Now, if you didn't recognize that song, we're going to pretend that it is because of generational or cultural differences and not because I missed about half of the notes. I am a terrible singer. All right. countless pop songs, as well as stories, books, myths, have centered around making a hard decision. The decider is weighing a complex set of benefits and costs. Do a thought experiment with me for a second. I'm going to propose a game, and I want you to think about whether you would choose to play. Now, if you've taken statistics or economics, I am not asking you what one should do. I'm asking, if I came up to you in the audience right now, what would you personally choose to do? All right, here's the deal. I'm going to give you 1,000 yuan. At this point, you can take that yuan and walk away, or you can play the game with me. The game is this. I'm going to flip two coins. If they both come up flowers, which has a 25% chance of occurring, then I'm going to give you 2,000 more dollars. You're going to triple your money and walk out of here with 3,000 yuan. But if they don't both show flowers, which has a 75% chance of happening, you give me my 1,000 yuan back. So you got a sure thing of 1,000 yuan, or you can try and triple your money. Now, there are no wrong answers here, promise, but I'm going to ask you to reveal your decision making here. So raise your hand if you would take the sure thing. Okay, all right, hands down. Raise your hand if you would choose to gamble. Okay, good, perfect. It turned out mixed, which is what I expected. It happened with my stats class that was also mixed this week when I tested this. So traditional economic rational utility theory would say that all of you should take the sure thing because the expected value of the sure thing, 1,000, is more than the expected value of the game that I was gonna let you play, which is 750 yuan. But not all of you did take the rational outcome. So for those of you that chose to play the game, the irrational outcome, why? Is it because you thrill at the prospect of gambling, elation? Is it because you salivated at the chance to make more money, greed? For those of you that did decide to take the sure thing, why? Is it because your roommate had to loan you 1,000 yuan for rent money last month and you feel pretty bad and you should probably pay them back? Guilt? Is it because you're broke right now and you're pretty stressed about it and this 1,000 yuan would let you worry a little bit less for a while? Fear. So rationally, you all should have taken the 1,000 yuan and walked away, but you didn't. You weighed your personal set of trade-offs and your current and projected future circumstances and decided what best applied to you. Our attitudes towards risk, as well as the things that make us choose the rational option or choose the irrational one, or at least hesitate on choosing the rational option, are what define us as us. They reveal our values, our strengths, our weaknesses. Our hard decisions are what make us us. They differentiate us from one another. Now, once upon a time, I was in a bar in Chicago on a Tuesday night, sobbing in the middle of December, which is very much like Harbin. It's cold, it is miserable, crying into a margarita, snot running down my face. It was not a good scene. And I called a friend, and he gave me this advice by way of trying to make me feel better. He tried to gamify failure a little bit for me, so hopefully if you ever find yourself crying in a bar in Harbin, freezing to death with snot down your face, this will be helpful for you too. He said that there are three things that make one an adult. The first is getting fired. The second is getting your heart broken. And the third is getting sued, because it means you got far enough to be worth shaking down for money in the court system. Now, this probably applies, this third one applies to a little bit more to the litigious American audiences. So two of the hardest decisions I have ever had to make me an adult in this framework: quitting a federal level political campaign and getting divorced. On the flip side of those decisions, I can now see that the tension between the making the decision for the rationally best outcome and all the factors that went into me hesitating and wanting to choose the irrational outcome are what define me as me, because they both revealed and galvanized my values. This first hard me defining decision was professional in nature. It was quitting the campaign. So I ran for Congress in the United States in 2018 in the midterm cycle. Congress is the federal level legislative body of the United States, the lawmakers. The process for running for Congress are two stages. First, each of the political parties, the two main political parties in the United States, has a runoff internally where they choose the candidate that they want to put forward in the general election. In the second stage, or in the general election here, the winners of each of those primary elections face off against one another, and then whoever wins that election becomes the newly elected congressional representative that represents the district. It takes a lot of money to run for Congress. In this election, the average spent for the winning seats was $2 million. That money goes towards advertising. So it's buying TV commercials, newspaper ads, to help get your message out there so voters understand why they want to vote for you. It comes from fundraising. So you have to call everyone you've ever known, as well as thousands of strangers you've never met, and beg them for money. It's a humbling experience. Unfortunately, halfway through the race, it became public that one of my other same party candidates in the primary, in the first stage, had a lot of personal wealth that we all hadn't predicted. So the odds of winning this election went from being a long shot to basically impossible. As I characterize it today, the rational decision was to quit the election. I had gotten in because I wanted to do good for the district. I thought that the current congressman was doing a disservice both to the district and to the country. He was hurting people. I thought that I could be a better decision maker than him, and I thought that winning the election was potentially doable. But those odds flipped. I had met the other candidate, the one with the personal wealth. I knew him. We'd sat next to each other at elections, and I thought that he would do a good job, certainly better than the current decision maker that was in Congress. Second, as I mentioned, you have to fundraise all this money. I was spending most of my days fundraising, making calls, asking people for money. And what I'm saying is, hey, I can win this race. I really need your help. We're gonna get a better person into Congress, and I think I'm that person. Can you help me today by giving me some money? Now, if I think that the odds have gone from long shot but doable to basically impossible, am I now taking that money in bad faith? So the value here is that I care a lot about other people's time, money, energy, and resources. So it's driving me to make the rational decision of let this other person do it who has a better shot and can achieve our objective of getting better representation in Congress, even if it's not me. And don't take people's money in bad faith. Be responsible. But that value that's coming down the rational side to quit the election is also the exact thing that seems irrational too and was driving those decisions. So I felt guilty. I felt so guilty that so many people had believed in me and committed their time and resources and energy, and I was just gonna quit and throw all that away. Guilt. Hope was keeping me in this election too on the irrational side. You definitely lose an election if you quit. If you fire yourself, zero chance. There's always a chance if you're in it, even if it's negligible, that it pays off. There's always a shot. And movies have trained us to love the long shot, even if it's not rational, i.e. statistically likely. The other ones in here, the obvious one, ego. Like, I look like I just couldn't hack it. I quit because it was hard. So guilt, hope, and ego, really hard to fight. In the end, I believe I made the rational decision to quit. And the rationality was driven by values. It was do the most good for the most amount of people. The irrational side is saying, I don't want to quit. Or did I? And am I using this framework to justify, of high-minded ideals to justify? Was it in fact hard and I just didn't want to do it anymore? I'm never going to know. But on the flip side, it took about a year and I got a little bit of clarity on it. So when I shut down the campaign, you've done a lot of fundraising and you have money. And so that money has to go somewhere. Part of that money went to the incumbent's campaign, or excuse me, not the incumbent, the campaign of my same party candidate, the one that I said had personal wealth and the reason I made the rational decision to drop out. Some of it went to his campaign. And some of it went to two women in other districts in both Illinois and Michigan. On election night of the general, about a year later, when the results of the election were announced, all three of those people won their seats. We'd gotten better people into Congress. Now, I cry a lot. If you see me crying, looking at my phone, and you're like, oh my God, did someone die? No, I am probably looking at cute puppies on the internet. So I cry a lot, but I sobbed on election night, and those tears were joy and relief. And I was surprised by the strength of my reaction. I hadn't realized that I was ruminating on, was that rational? Was it irrational? Should I have done it? Was I being weak? What were all the drivers behind that? But that clarity that came from later, all that rumination was resolved when I had a little bit of a inkling that we did do something. Not only my effort, but all the people that believed in me, donated and helped, committed their time, energy, and resources, had accomplished some good. So based on my reaction, I do believe today that that decision was rational. The second decision that defines me as an adult was personal. I broke my own heart getting divorced. Since this is Haaf musical theater, another song, should I stay or should I go now? If I go, there will be trouble. If I stay, there will be double. Thank you, good. Laughing is a great reaction to my singing. That's better than covering your ears. That song is by The Clash, and in this song, the singer is trying to weigh whether he should stay in a relationship or whether he should go, and he knows that the costs are double if he stays. He knows the rational decision is to go, but damn if he doesn't want to stay. Damn if I didn't want to stay in that marriage. Collapsing it means that you are losing the family that you thought you were going to have until you died. It's losing the person you've structured your entire life around. Now, it took me the last three years of that 10-year relationship to accept that the rationally better outcome was to end it. We both had very different visions for the future, and none of the compromises that we were going to have to make were probably going to be worth it. When we were 22, the odds of happily ever after weren't a sure thing. When we were 32, the odds of happily ever after had flipped to practically impossible. Rationally, I know that we're better apart. Any of the trade-offs or compromises that we would have had to make around kids and careers and places we wanted to live, we're going to make us jointly less satisfied with our lives. And every day that we didn't make that decision was more time wasted, and it was more compromises that we were making. We were going to get to the same end, but it was going to be more expensive. The second piece of that, and it was incredibly unlikely, especially how the 10 years, how we had gotten to that place, and the damage that we had both jointly done to that relationship, that we were going to be able to turn that situation around. Second, none of the fixes that would have turned that situation around were likely to have done anything other than just double down on the risk and the inevitable costs. So the value that was coming into play here too, that was driving this rational decision to leave, was that I value not hurting other people. Even in that moment, as angry as I was, not the person that I was angry at, my then husband, nor the future innocent children that we probably would have brought into that had we kept going. So don't hurt other people. So what are the irrational factors that were driving me to stay in that? The first one, hope. There that one is again. Hope that I'll figure out the right thing to say to turn this whole thing around. Hope that life deals us a set of circumstances that change everything and makes decisions for us. Integrity, so values coming down on the irrational side too. I had promised till death do us part, and I do what I say I'm gonna do. I'm basically walking that back. Shame, I had just quit an election 3 months ago and fired myself from office. I now look like an unstable bad bet who also can't hack it in a marriage. That was a rough year. And then lastly, in addition to shame, grief, I think that what you don't necessarily hear when people talk about divorces or ending any very, very long-term relationship is that you're going to lose about half of the other relationships in your life too. Now, our friends and family are very good people who didn't take sides, and they weren't petty, but I spent 10 years going to Christmases with his family, and realistically in life, that's never going to happen again. So we have hope, integrity, shame, grief, all really hard to fight. Made the irrational decision to leave, but he got there first. I would say he realized the rational outcome and started signaling it to me years before I figured it out and was willing to accept it. I was fighting irrationality too long. So it would be easy to cast him as the ex-husband who wronged me. But on the flip side, I can see that he was also hesitating and wrestling with all these rational versus irrational factors as well. So those were driven by his values, which are also admirable. He's not the person that wronged me. He is someone else who was uniquely struggling with his own set of trade-offs driven by his admirable values. Now, lest anyone think that I'm some evolved saint that's, oh, good, she's not mad at her ex-husband. I am sure that if I see a picture of this of a new girlfriend on Facebook at some point, I will text my sister and be like, her hair is terrible and her dress is terrible. Well, I'm actually thinking about the fact that, like, her hair looks really good and trying to figure out what salon she goes to. And also that dress was risky, but respect for that. So I'm petty. Don't worry. So all these I framed these two decisions as rational versus irrational. But when you're in the fog of war, it certainly doesn't feel like that. It's not that clear. It's only on the flip side with some perspective and some reflection that I can see now that the reason that I was hesitating to choose the rationally best outcome was the struggle with all these irrational factors, and both of those things were driven by my values. I still don't know if I'm seeing it clearly, but regardless, not only the drivers, rational versus irrational, these decisions, but my reflection upon them is forever going to define me. So I am never going to fundraise again for political or other purposes without very long, protracted, informed reflection on what it means to be a steward of other people's resources. I'm never going to commit to a relationship again without having a very honest evaluation of what compromises we are asking of one another. This hesitation between choosing the rational and the irrational and making these decisions is driven by the values that were both revealed and galvanized from this unique set of very personal experiences. So these hesitations on the decisions are me. Back to our 1,000 yuan game. You all should have chosen the $1,000 sure thing rational outcome, but you didn't. You hesitated, and some of you chose the irrational, and that was driven by your own sets of trade-offs and considerations. Rational utility theory would have said you all choose the 1,000, but it couldn't quite predict all those choices. Decision theory, a different school of thought, tries to proxy some of these irrational factors, but still can't quite predict 100%. Sociology and psychology have their own frameworks for modeling human behavior, but no model yet exists in any field that can 100% predict what somebody's going to do. Computer scientists are pursuing the creation of artificial intelligence or algorithmic decision makers. They're going to satisfy a pre-specified set of objectives under an evaluation of benefits and cost trade-offs. We can make these decision makers look rational in the environments that they're given in, and we can even make them perfectly mimic what would look to be a pattern of human decision making. But they're never going to have this tension between rational and irrational, have the irrational values and emotions that are making them choose against the rational best outcome. So if our tension and the reason that we have this conflict between rational and irrational differentiates us not only as humans, does it also differentiate the concept of humanity itself? So on that light note, you guys have been a great audience. Thank you, Shanghai. I'll be here all week. And call me if you have any KTV cameo performance needs. Thanks.